What if the people that we trust to give us health advice are blurring the lines between science and sales? This isn't just a debate between doctors and researchers. It's changing the way that all of us think about our health. So this goes way deeper than I initially thought. It's not just about social media and supplements, but this is about trust. And to really understand this dynamic, I don't think I can do this on my own. I'm writing an email right now to Dr. Mike to see if he will help explain this and get to the bottom of this dynamic.
Over 25 million social media followers. Our next guest is one of the most influential medical educators online.
This was a big long shot, but Dr. Mike has just got back to me and he's in.
They sprinkle in the preliminary research and get people excited about that. It causes people to lose focus, at least in my experience, and that's why I think it's a problem.
Social media has transformed the relationship between patients, doctors, and researchers. The once clear roles of a researcher and doctor are now beginning to overlap. And as researchers earn millions selling supplements, doctors are left with serious questions and doubts. Is this a win for society, or does it pose real risks to patients? Let's unpack these issues with Dr. Mike. I'm Jack, a doctor in the UK, and let's get into this.
So resveratrol is this molecule in red wine that is thought to protect the French from high-fat foods.
I'm Andrew Huberman.
A lot of times you're talking about initial stage research.
Here's a visual walking you through the complex process that it takes to get either a drug or a medical device approved in the UK. And the research arm looks pretty much the same everywhere. You can see how in the research phase, there are so many steps along this process. Researchers go through the preliminary process using the science of how the body goes right and how it can go wrong to develop drugs and medical devices. In 1928, Alexander Fleming observed a mold in his lab called Penicillium notatum, killing the bacteria that were around it.
Sir Alexander Fleming, for the initial discovery of penicillin.
What he found in that petri dish was a mold that had drifted through the air from another lab and which had stopped the spread of a bacteria culture Fleming had been growing, dead in its tracks.
He then went through this process of testing his drug until we had mass-produced antibiotics.
Though he didn't have the resources to advance his discovery, other researchers did. And by the 1940s, they had created an antibiotic from the same type of mold, an antibiotic they called penicillin.
Fleming only became famous 10 years after publishing his initial breakthrough findings. You can see where I'm going here. Things have changed a lot.
So I stand here as a representative of a field called aging science.
I'm Andrew Huberman, and I'm a professor of neurobiology and ophthalmology at Stanford School of Medicine.
The primary role of a researcher was and still is to understand the science, form hypotheses, and then prove those hypotheses right or wrong. That placed them in a completely different place to doctors. Almost 100 years later, this dynamic has changed, and recently the roles have come closer together. Let's take Andrew Huberman as an example. He's a neurobiologist and ophthalmologist from Stanford with his own research lab. He has one of the biggest podcasts in the world where he's taken on a patient-facing role to educate the public and sell supplements as tools to help. This tectonic shift has had a massive impact on where patients get their health information from and who they get it from. This is where the disagreements between doctors and researchers begin. Before we get into that, let's look at the positive side of this.
To have more evidence-based researchers talk about science, get people excited about science, take better control of their health is a win in my book.
Dr. Mike brings up a really valid point here. We're living in a society where there's a growing desire to understand our health better. And as a practicing doctor, I've observed that people no longer take a doctor's advice as gospel. They question everything. They want to know that how their physiology works and how their habits and medications impact it. I think that's a really positive step because understanding your health better will lead to more informed health decisions in the future. Having a wide variety of different voices discussing science and health is really, really positive. It means no matter your background, there will be someone that you resonate with that can teach you about your health. However, coming back to our visual, not all advice is made equal. And not all research is made equal as well. People end up selling personal conclusions as facts. And to really understand this, we need some examples. Researchers often find themselves working in this area of our flowchart. Preliminary studies are where breakthroughs start, but not where we should be providing advice from. Dr. Mike summed this up really well.
These days, when scientists are talking about research that has happened, a lot of times they're talking about initial stage research, which is not ready for prime time generalized advice. And that's an important distinction for me as a clinician. When I make a recommendation to a patient, I will oftentimes explain to them where that recommendation is coming from, usually backed by really good quality evidence. So we're thinking meta-analyses, randomized controlled studies, or just a preponderance of quality research.
Let's take Huberman's episode on boosting energy and immune system function. He recommends ashwagandha as a way to combat stress.
One of the most common ones is ashwagandha, and it has a powerful anxiolytic anti-anxiety effect. I think ashwagandha comes through as kind of the heavy hitter in this department.
An immunologist, Andrea Love, had some interesting thoughts on his recommendation. She found that the studies he cited were in rats, so early on in this flowchart. One meta-analysis in humans showed that it might help with sleep, particularly in people with insomnia, but found no significant effect on quality of life. Overall, the research concluded that there is weak confidence in the link between anxiety and ashwagandha, which warrants further high-quality studies. You see, this is where the nuance arises. Didn't we just say that meta-analyses are high quality? Yes, we did. But recommending changes in lifestyle is very different to suggesting you buy a drug. When doctors are prescribing medications for patients, it has to pass even more checks, proving to be both cost-effective and effective at treating the problem. Ashwagandha isn't ready for that recommendation in my book. Here we can see how the roles are merging. Huberman has taken a step from researcher to almost prescriber, prescribing supplements for his audience. That gets worse when he makes a personal profit from them, like with AG1 and Element. His credibility as a Stanford researcher has become one of their key selling points. The other problem is that in this early stage, scientists all have different theories about what the potential solutions could be. Take David Sinclair from Harvard.
So resveratrol is this molecule in red wine that is thought to protect the French from high fat foods. Yeah. And we discovered that it activates an enzyme in the body called Sirt1, one of these Sirtuin protective enzymes that's activated by hunger and exercise.
Okay.
So resveratrol we discovered as the first molecule that could mimic calorically restricted diet and exercise.
I take a gram of it every morning.
He sold his company Sirtris to GSK for $720 million. And then they shut it down a few years later because the research down here didn't support the research that he did up here. This just proves that the theories of even the most influential scientists can be wrong, and often are. It can get confusing to patients when these scientists all disagree on the same topic, and the public is left basically not knowing what to think. You may be thinking though, they're just supplements, Jack. Is this really such a big deal? The person looking for advice online and buying these supplements may have a real medical problem, requiring real, medically proven solutions. The problem is that they've listened to a researcher from a leading institution like Harvard or Stanford and bought what they think is a science-backed solution. The opportunity cost of that is it may delay them from seeking real medical input from a doctor, or from doing the less glamorous but real science-backed habits.
The problem is what goes viral on social media these days is content that is largely focused on new innovations. And new innovations covered prematurely can actually have negative implications. So often I see my patients spending time, effort, money on things that are not actually improving their health. They're going to buy a cold plunge for their next ice bath as opposed to focusing and improving their sleep.
You may be thinking that I'm being a bit hypocritical here though. Not every piece of research that I cite in these videos has made it through all of these stages. That brings us on to our final chapter. I really don't want this to seem like a personal attack on Huberman. I've learned loads from him over the years, and as we said at the start, having that wide variety of different voices educating on health is a win. This is more of a personal exploration for myself, to know what I should and shouldn't cover in these videos, and also to help you explore what information you should and shouldn't trust. I've covered preliminary research on rats to try and help you understand how running impacts your brain. Was that bad advice? I don't think so, because my only incentive with the videos is to encourage you to make small, healthy changes to your habits. I don't want you to buy anything. In my opinion, covering exciting new research is essential so that we can understand the cutting edge of science and try to apply that to our lives or be aware of it. However, when these scientists sell products implying that the science supports them, when it really doesn't, that's where my problem lies. They're almost saying, my affiliate link to this supplement is supported by science. And that's where I draw the line. Dr. Mike had a really interesting perspective that this early research may act as a distraction.
And while, yes, I know many of the scientists out there do talk about the basics, the diet, the sleep, the mental health component, the fact that they sprinkle in the preliminary research and get people excited about that, it causes people to lose focus, at least in my experience, and that's why I think it's a problem.
I'll leave you to make up your own mind. Do you think covering preliminary research is a distraction? Do you think it's okay for these researchers to use their reputation to sell supplements and products? Let me know in the comments and subscribe for more evidence-based advice on how to build healthy habits. Thanks for watching, and thanks so much to Dr. Mike for working with me on this one.